graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Advisory. Due to subject matter, Exile contains realistically harsh language and sexual content. Graphic Audio presents Exile by Lisa M. Bradley. Narrated by Tia Shearer Basset and a full cast.
The man had beheaded my brother. I couldn't stop imagining it as I sat nearly recumbent in the passenger seat of his steel-gray stingray. Tank ignored my inspection, avoided even glancing my way as he drove us to Mute's Roadhouse out on Maiden Lane. Before the spill, Maiden Lane had been a quiet cul-de-sac. Now it was more bottom of the bag than ever, despite being in the outer radius. Still, getting there didn't require half the concentration Tank was faking. He'd designed Mutes, had gotten down and hauled sheetrock and hammered nails with the sulking townies Mute arm-twisted and blackmailed into working. Tank had even blacktopped the parking lot, raked that stinking asphalt soup in the middle of an August night. So he knew where Mutes was and how to get there. He just didn't want to look at me or my blue mini dress or the line of my thighs pressed together. Maybe I scared him. He pulled into the parking lot, headlights glitzing off the rhinestone and spangles of the hooker promenade in front of Mutes. The tires crunched over broken beer bottles, and I winced in spite of myself. Sure, Tank was an outsider, but he'd been in town 3 years, plenty long enough to have puncture-proof tires. Even so, a 1970 Corvette Stingray Coupe deserved better. Tank must have been checking me out because he caught my flinch, mistook it for fear.
You sure you want to do this?
This? I looked across the lot bleached by floodlights, watched couples emerge from the shadows alongside the roadhouse to scope us out. This. Appear in public with my brother's killer. Burn the last bridges to my family. Spray paint my suicide note in letters 6 feet tall. I inhaled the sandalwood spice coming off Tank. I unbuckled my seatbelt. I'm sure. Are you? He didn't say anything. Didn't have to. Uncertainty cocked his jaw. An 8 on Luciano's American masculinity scale, I decided. But he got out and met me in front of the sleek silver beast. As he escorted me through the gauntlet of leaning motorcycles to Mute's door, his hand didn't quite touch the small of my back, but I felt its heat. And the answering heat on my cheekbones, the hollow of my throat. The hooker crew chiefs paused negotiations to marvel at Tank, then dropped their gazes to me. Tank and I nodded as we passed through their beer and blunts miasma. Inside, the jukebox blared classic rock. No one noticed our entrance, but the moment Tank started crossing the sawdusted floor, the crowd parted for his immense form. And then the whispers started. The roadhouse felt bigger inside than out, and it was packed with people who knew me, knew my brother, knew my brother's killer. My skin tingled. Mutes was one of Exile's only no-kill zones. That's why, when I'd propositioned him, Tank had insisted we have our date here. That, and Tank had some arrangement with Mute. But that was small consolation with everyone eyeing us like steaks. The street wars whet powerful appetites. Tank ignored the crowd's gawking more convincingly than he had my staring. He guided me along a curving honey Weiss wall that divided the bar from the dance floor toward a spiral staircase that looked like the bastard of a conch shell and a baby grand piano. Black, gleaming, and pearlescent, the staircase embraced us, buffered us from the riffraff. Even so, I had to concentrate as we ascended the polished treads. I was wearing newish fuck-me pumps, and vibrations, tank climbing behind me, the jukebox feverish rock music funneled up my already trembling legs. Then we reached the surreal stability of the Guinness Black mezzanine. It jetted glassy, seemingly unsupported, over the muffled dance floor. We sat at Tank's table, off-limits to anyone else, and a little breathless, I peered over the edge of the mezzanine at the dancers below. Plenty looked, stared, glared right back. A knot of warriors, part of my dead brother's crew, muttered near the bar. Their new leader, Chaz, bared nicotine-stained teeth at me and grabbed his crotch. I turned back to Tank. Studying me, he hadn't noticed Chaz's threat. I gestured around at the mezzanine.
So how does it not crash down onto the dance floor?
He gave me a longer answer than I expected. KSI yield requirements, seismic loadings, PSF live loads, and I don't know what else. He was one of those no-bullshit characters who assumed that if you asked, then you really wanted to know. When he finished, his mouth squeezed up. Not a smile, exactly. More like a facial shrug. Ripple of the zygomatic major, slight pucker of the incisivi labii. No movement of the orbicularis oculi.
I don't know what you just said, but I think I get the gist. It's physics.
Physics.
We sat eyeing one another, silent, for a couple of minutes. He knew that I knew that he'd murdered my brother William. Hell, the whole town knew. You can't race down a residential street on your motorcycle swinging an axe at people without somebody taking notice. Even in exile. Even during a street war. I looked away. And looked right back. Tank was the most beautiful man I'd ever seen. Granted, I'd spent most of the last 6 months locked in my bedroom, the room farthest from the street, working on my thesis. But my thesis was on male beauty in mainstream American cinema, so I wasn't easily awed. His head was shaved, the crescents of parietal bone pleasingly juxtaposed with the planes of his long brown face. I mentally traced the temporal lines down the subtle slopes of his zygomatic bones. No jarring chiseled cheekbones. Over the baby smooth philtrum, down his mental protuberance, that number 8 chin, over a delectable Adam's apple, and down, down, down to that massive chest. He was so muscular that despite his loose black t-shirt, he looked like an illustration from Grey's Anatomy. Had Grey been a lusty spinster with a predilection for multi-ethnic men. From the look in his near-black eyes, I knew that he knew I wasn't thinking of my headless brother. It seemed to make him uneasy. He hailed a waitress so she could bring me a glass of ice water. I drained it. A few minutes later, he called her again. And then again. I tried to slow down. The glasses were the size of cannon shells, and my bladder was maybe the size of a hand grenade. Something had to give. I pushed away from the table. Excuse me. I hurried downstairs, my legs trembling, bladder near bursting. The rambunctious rock surged over me as I joined the clot of bodies on the dance floor. I hadn't gotten halfway to the facilities when someone grabbed my wrist and yanked. Ugh! I would have toppled, but there were too many bodies. As it was, I flattened my nose against someone else's biceps. That person shoved me off, and suddenly Chaz was in my face, close enough I could count wiry black beard hairs, tally steroid acne scars. Unlit cigarette clamped between his lips, he ground my carpals in his fist.
You got time for a dance, Heidi?
I braced myself, used my free hand to shove him in the chest.
I don't dance with William's friends.
Not even now. Chaz's cigarette bobbed as he glanced at the mezzanine behind me.
But your dance with that outsider killed your brother.
I ain't dancing with anybody. I'm trying to get to the can.
What are you up to? Your mama know where you are? You guys plotting something?
What do you think? Ooh! I stomped his foot. My heel skidded off his steel-toed boot. Or do you think?
You okay, hey?
I turned around, found Romero Cantu at my back. His dark hair gel-scrunched like permanent bedhead, and on his sleek brown cheekbone, a new crescent-shaped scab. Maybe from the end of a metal pipe?
I'd be better if I could get to the bathroom.
Romero took my arm, his calluses a familiar grit against my skin, and pulled me out of Chaz's grip.
Come on, man, let her through. You don't want her pissing on your boots, do you? That's kind of kinky.
Romero jostled us past, and Chaz stepped back, though Romero was smaller than him and not jacked up on steroids.
Kinky! Shit, you'd know kinky, right, Tattoo? Slurping up your brother!
We didn't hear the rest, weaving through the crowd, but it was a classic refrain, mindless as a kiss chorus.
You okay?
His breath curled sweet with cardamom and coke. I'd licked the taste from his lips often enough to know. It still made my mouth water. I gritted my teeth. Gotta go is all. We spotted the line of women leaning against the wall.
Sweet soul, come on. I'll take you to the men's.
He started to tug me in the other direction, but I resisted. Not enough to go timber in my heels, but enough that he stopped. I looked toward the mezzanine, though not long enough to see Tank. I don't think that's appropriate tonight.
You know, would it be appropriate if your date bothered to protect you from William's thugs? What's he doing letting you walk into this rattler den?
It was his idea. No one's gonna start shit at mutes. Romero's grip tightened on my arm.
What did I just haul you away from, burra? A Tupperware pitch?
Out of the corner of my eye, I saw the line to the women's room growing longer. Come on, you're not mad at Tank, you're mad at me, and I need to pee. Romero huffed, but he let me join the line. He even waited with me, despite dirty looks from the other women. Maybe they thought he was going in with me. He turned me loose, leaned against the wall.
Sammy asked about you the other day. Wants to know why you don't come around no more. Didn't know what to tell the kid. Don't know myself.
Were we still on that? I hadn't been to the Cantu's house in 6 months, since the last time I'd failed the exam that could have bailed me from exile. You know why I don't come around.
Not really. Carlos ain't dating like you wanted him to. He just works harder.
Well, that's his choice. Carlos talked around things, not his brother Romero. Romy didn't bother to keep his voice down either.
What about me? Even if Carlos did start dating some nice girl, some girl suitable to his position as liaison, what about me?
Maybe you need to find a girl and settle down too.
I'll settle down when I'm dead.
He jerked his chin in the general direction of Chaz, then Tank.
You want me to wait for you?
I'll be fine. But keep Chaz distracted when I come out.
You sure Chaz is the one you need to worry about?
Romero left it at that and stomped away. I checked the clock as I left the can. Van damn it! I'd been MIA almost 15 minutes. Tank would think I'd ditched him. I hurried back upstairs, this time unmolested by any of William's friends, although Chaz watched me from a corner of the bar. Tank was still at his table, but he'd been joined by an Asian-esque woman and a slightly grimy white guy in a motorcycle jacket. The guy had taken my seat across from Tank. I smiled uncertainly, smoothed my dress over my hips as we were introduced. I recognized her. Serena. Apple-round cheeks, semi-permanent nasolabial creases, no epicanthic fold, slightest of upper lid creases topped by pencil-stroke eyebrows. About 10 years older than me. Not really a native, but more than an outsider. She'd had the misfortune to be in our southwest Texas town with her mom on the day of the spill, and she'd been quarantined like the rest of us. She was clearly attached to Sweeney, almost literally. Her burgundy-polished nails winked in the light as she squeezed his arm. Sweeney had a long, oval face that looked all the longer for the frequently broken aquiline nose and his slightly cleft chin, the droopy eyes and slanting eyebrows. He was mouth-breathing, so I saw one too many teeth, an extralateral incisor on the upper right. Older than me, but that didn't account for the permanent forehead furrow. When he smiled, the furrow deepened, as did the crow's feet around his muddy, yellow eyes. So far as I could tell, it was a genuine smile. Tank pulled out the chair beside him so I could sit, then rested his arm along the back of the chair behind me. I soaked my panties, but it wasn't my bladder's fault. To distract myself, I imagined Sweeney with his head cut off. Aside from the yellow eyes and extra tooth, he was standard-issue street warrior. It could have been his headless body in the street 2 days ago, rather than William's. I felt a little better about the confusion I'd experienced then. How nothing had made sense until some thug matched William's head to the rest of his body, and it dawned on me why Mother was hugging a bloody, bony duffel. Why she was screaming on her knees. Serena curled black hair around two fingers and nodded.
Yeah, Heidi Palermo. When'd you become such a hermit? I mean, what do you do in that house all day?
Sweeney kicked her under the table, but she ignored it. I did too. No way was I telling the truth, that I'd been messed up since failing the exit exam again. So I mumbled a little about my studies. Carefully avoided the word thesis, of course. No point in exposing myself as even more of a freak. But Serena announced that she loved movies. A lot of folks in exile do. Escapist, you know? After 10 minutes or so, more Serena's yakking than mine, Sweeney nudged her and said it was time to go. Serena pulled a face, but scooted her chair back as Sweeney and Tank shook hands. Tank half-waved, tensed his zygomatic major at Serena as they left.
You want some of the aids?
I shivered, shook my head. Not hungry. Partly because I kept remembering the way Sweet William's neck had oozed arterial blood. More because I was crazy horny. Around Tank, my sex drive, always pretty generous, ramped up to ridiculous. Can we go?
Go where?
Look, Chaz is here and he's confused enough he's not gonna follow us. Nobody else in my brother's crew will dare jump you without his say-so. And I think most everyone else is waiting to see how this shitstorm flies, so can we go now?
Go where?
I considered dousing myself with the ice water. Home. Your home. He blinked, opened his mouth as if to speak. Didn't. But when I pushed my chair back, he stood and gestured after you. Mother was pregnant with Sweet William when an unregulated semi biffed the turn into the parking lot for the Quantex mixing plant. I was 3. And we lived close enough to the industrial park that I heard the truck's 6,500-gallon cylindrical tank rolling like a giant beer can across 3 lanes of traffic. Father, who'd been leaning under the hood of a pickup in our backyard, said I scrambled up his leg and onto his back like a chimp, said he nearly severed his thumb in the fan blade. The semi's tank wasn't properly annealed. It crumpled and cracked, spilling a toxin, to this day undisclosed, that ate into the surrounding vehicles, some of them ferrying other chemicals for Quantex. Within minutes, a gangrene yellow fog blanketed half the town. The neighborhoods nearest Ground Zero, like my family's, became the inner radius. The ones farther out became the outer radius. Both zones were indefinitely quarantined by the federal government due to what the media called spill-induced rage. Technically, Exile was half of an already existing town, the other half cleared out by mandatory evacuation. But we rezoned and renamed ourselves. And if anybody called Exile by its old name, they got schooled fast with a blunt object. The way I heard it, even though Mother was working the phones at Quantex that day, the EPA and FEMA agents assigned to her case had insisted she'd be all right. Until she got into a fist fight with one and broke the lady's cheekbone, blinding her. Granted, socking a FEMA agent is no sign of mental imbalance, but it grew hard to argue the diagnosis. Before the feds managed to place Mother, waddling pregnant, under house arrest, she'd beaten several more folks senseless. The feds finally strapped monitoring bracelets on her and a few other felonious troublemakers. And Mother was confined to a quarter-mile run around the house. Still too much leash, if you ask me. In any case, William soon came out into the world to crack more distant kneecaps for her. William was 20 years old when Tank drove by him on a black Kawasaki Ninja and whacked his head off with an axe. So ended my brother's short but otherwise unremarkable life. That he lasted as long as he did, with no particular speed, strength, or menace other than the glitter-kill eyes and brute body stench of your typical warrior, might have seemed uncanny. But really, it was the product of my grudging expertise and his weaseliness. I was the family medic, though I refused to sit on the sidelines and watch like other crew's medics. I figured if William croaked in the few seconds it took me to run down from my bedroom, I couldn't have saved his sorry ass anyway. Which, yeah, QED. In any case, William rarely attacked uninjured warriors, and seldom alone. But the week he died, the usual street psychosis had cranked up tenfold, and William must have been swept along by the bloody tide. He'd ditched Chaz and run across the street to yank a crowbar out of some guy's chest, left him to die of a sucking chest wound when Tank came along. Was I supposed to cry? For sweet William? Back in the inner radius, I twitched when I realized which path Tank was taking. Rather than cruising northbound on Cricket and using the side entrance to his lot, he drove west on Raven. He steered around chunks of battle debris, sometimes nearer, sometimes farther from the concrete traffic barricades lining the streets, a cursory attempt to keep the fighting off people's lawns. Not that much of anything grew anymore, even dandelions. The ray's headlights glittered over the broken bottles that spiked my parents' barricades. I shrank in my seat, wishing my atoms would merge with the leather upholstery. The wars had shattered the street lamps up and down the block, but every bulb in my parents' house blazed.
Murderer!
Mother paced, screeching, in front of the living room windows. At least she wouldn't be able to see beyond her own crazed reflection. By now, my family had to have known I'd snuck out, despite the mandatory mourning period decreed by Mother. They probably didn't know where I'd gone, or with whom. Even if Chaz had called them, they wouldn't have heard the phone over Mother's screaming. Still, I held my breath until we'd safely passed my parents' place. Tank turned into a narrow driveway between concrete barriers on his side of Raven. He pulled up to the closed garage, lowered the ray's pop-up headlights, and unbottled.
Wait for me.
I did wait, dumbfounded. Why wasn't he driving into the fortified garage? Why would he leave the car unprotected in the driveway? Maybe he'd been in exile too long, I thought, as he came around the front. Maybe he was as nuts as any of us now. He opened my door, reached for my hand.
Watch your step.
So he expected us to saunter right up to the front door? We were practically across from my parents' house. I raised a skeptical eyebrow, but silent, I let him lead me down the dark path. On our right, on the northeast corner of Tank's property, loomed 8-foot-high timber and concrete palisades that formed a V, buffering the house from Cricket and Raven and creating a dead end. Panic prickled my heart like stripped electrical wires. What if Chaz? What if all my brother's crew showed up and cornered us on Tank's gravel lawn? I imagined the sheen of starlight on machetes. They didn't even have to come that close. If they dug up a contraband shotgun or rifle, they could stand in the driveway and gun us down. The feds might storm in afterwards, impose martial law, but tell that to my perforated corpse. I resisted the urge to peek over my shoulder. Sweat collecting on my upper lip, I focused on the sidewalk, sidestepped rocks. Tank stopped at the door.
You okay?
Yeah, fine. You? He paused, hand on the lock, and squinted at me in the dark. I didn't know what he was looking for, or at. And before I could figure it out, he turned to the door, let the optical scan do its thing. Inside, a row of track lights glimmered at our entry. Walking past me, he glanced my way and almost laughed, it seemed. I felt pinned to the ground by his suggestion of a grin. That micron of tension in his outer orbicularis oculi, the only thing holding me up.
Come on, I'll show you my deck.
I blushed.
My deck.
We crossed the living room, our shoes quiet on the cork floor. We passed a dark kitchen that smelled of nothing, walked down a hall carved with empty alcoves, into an echoing den paved with flagstone, and back outdoors to a patio, austere with shadow. He led me toward stairs rising into the dark, a tube of white light wrapped around the handrail, illuminating the steps. So I didn't have to stick quite so close to Tank, but I did. My thighs were slippery, my nipples tight. Up top, dense, fire-resistant canvas cloaked the cedar deck on three sides. The house's second story provided the deck's fourth wall. The south side, hanging over the backyard, had a built-in bench. But I gravitated to the point farthest from my parents' house. Somewhere out of sight, the moon had climbed over Exile's meek skyline. Gray light filtered through the tarry smoke of the tire fires ringing the inner radius. Near enough to hold hands, though we didn't, Hank and I stared out at the sooty night.
Why are you here?
I shrugged in reply.
You fascinated with me because I killed your brother?
I'm fascinated by you because you're fascinating. He cocked his head as he searched the sky, maybe for stars.
Anybody could have killed your brother. If not me the other day, then Sweeney today, somebody else tomorrow.
I know. That only makes William unremarkable, not you. He took my wrist, pulled me to stand against him. My nose was on level with the middle of his chest. I had to crane my neck to look him in the eye.
You hear your mom crying?
I nodded.
Why aren't you crying?
I shrugged again. No one ever cried for me. He held my gaze a moment, a long one, before nodding.
No one ever cried for me either.
I slipped my arms around his neck. I had to tiptoe, and he had to lean down. I kissed him. He didn't close his eyes. His lids drooped 3/4 of the way, but he didn't let me out of his sight. Fine with me. I couldn't get enough looking at him. I stepped back, holding the kiss, holding him, pulling him toward the railing so he could brace his arms. We'd need the leverage. When he realized where we were going, what I was doing, his legs locked. I stopped. I waited, heart loud and annoying in my ears, my fingers hooked in his belt loops, my mouth open on his chin. He seemed to reach a decision. He turned us and walked backward until we hit the edge of the bench. Okay, good. He sat, and I straddled him, my back to the house, my hips aching over the span of his thighs. He ran his hands up my arms as we kissed, his thumbs grazing my biceps, seeking the telltale bump of my contraceptive implant. I wonder if he felt me smiling into our kiss. Didn't my reputation precede me? He watched my face as we fucked. I watched back until it felt too good. If he closed his eyes when he came, I was too far gone to notice. After, he led me to his bedroom. I staggered after him, cunt sore, and dead tired from the chaos of the past 2 days. We crawled into bed and lay like meth spoons. I tried to wait until I heard him snoring, but failed. Of course, I'd drunk all that water at Mutes, so an hour later I woke with my bladder in silent scream mode. Slowly, carefully, I tried to ease from the bed. Hank's hand shot out and grabbed my arm.
What's wrong?
Nothing. I have to pee.
His hand relaxed, but maybe only one KSI? I still had to pull free. When I crawled back to bed, he clenched me to him, my back against his solid chest.
Miss you.
He wasn't talking to me. More likely someone in his dream.
Shh. It's all right.
I patted the arm he'd coiled around me.
We're all right.
Awake, technically. I lay still, eyes closed. Not playing possum, just a sleepwalker's habit. I listened to the shower running, inched my fingers out, testing. The mattress felt cool. Hank must have been up for several minutes. The guy was a radiator and left everything he touched, especially me, hot. I wondered where I'd go when he gave me the boot. Home was out of the question. Chaz had to have tattled by now. I rolled over and fell back asleep. It felt like seconds later that I woke again. Tank stood at the side of the bed, leaning over me.
Pick up some stuff before they start up out there. Go back to sleep.
I think I nodded. I tried to. I fell asleep again, half smiling at the warm tickle of his rough fingertips against my lips. My imagination, surely, but sexy nonetheless. I woke again when the garage door closed with the stingray safely inside. Hallelujah, that car deserved a military escort. Hearing Tank move through the house, I sat up to rub my eyes clean, brush my hair behind my ears. Didn't matter if I'd hardly slept the last 2 days, I had to snap out of it. Tank might offer me breakfast before kicking me to the curb. He was odd enough. But where was I going next? He appeared in the doorway.
Hey.
His gravelly tone rattled my blood, as did the sight of him standing there, carpenter pants clasping his thick thighs, black t-shirt skimming his broad pecs.
Hey.
I clenched my legs together, hoping he couldn't smell my lust from across the room. I noticed my knees were scuffed from dancing on the deck. He took a few steps closer to the bed, ratcheting up my pulse again, and tossed a sack in my lap.
What did you bring me?
A toothbrush. Red. A hairbrush. Black. A bottle of shampoo. Vanilla. Glycerin soap. Also vanilla, my favorite. None of it government issue.
Why vanilla?
That's what you smelled like when you tracked me down. When you asked if I was the one who...
killed William.
The day after William's beheading, I'd snuck out of the house. Not that I'd had to be that stealthy. My family was still reeling, his crew moping, so nobody noticed I wasn't in my room, grieving on demand. Thus, I was free to follow the gossip I'd gleaned from the crew. The same details that disgusted William's thugs intrigued me. Tank, an intermittent warrior, had already gone back to work. The very concept of choosing to work was anathema to my brother's crew. In exchange for a government salary plus hazard pay supplied by Quantex, part of a settlement hammered out in the 20-teens, outsiders were supposed to implement jobs programs in Exile. Tank was one of the few outsiders who didn't just go through the motions. His building company got shit done.
Motherfucking outsider ran back to his Lego.
Who does he think he is?
The building side like nothing ever happened.
Clearly, they felt insulted by Tank's unwillingness to hide, but weren't sure what to do about his unconventional behavior. Rather unconventional myself, I'd skirted the battles junking up the streets, because despite the crew's outrage, the street wars didn't stop so we could mourn the legs of William, and hurried along Gatling Drive, unsure how much time I had before Mother noticed my absence. Gatling Drive was a scrubby, jaundiced path that looped around Exile. About every 20 yards, a stolen street or traffic sign stabbed the droughty Texas dirt. The signs marked how close you could get to the trench before setting off the feds' alarms. The trench, 8 feet wide, 9 feet at its deepest, served as an open grave for any fool who charged the feds' electrified fence. On the other side of the fence loomed mirror-glassed panopticons, each with an observation deck studded with mounted machine guns, the Gatlings. The panopticons cast shadows every quarter mile. I kept my eyes to the ground, held my breath as I dashed through each unblinking darkness. No one knew how many of the towers were actually manned, or if they had to be. After the spill, all Exiles had been injected with subcutaneous ID chips in their thenar eminence, that meaty bump under the thumb. Some folks said it was your chip crossing a magnetic threshold that really set off the alarms, not a schmuck standing guard. Still, I hated those watchtowers. Hated the shadow noose they looped around us. Everyone else did too, so Gatling Drive was the path of least resistance. Not that anyone could have stopped me. I was burning down a fuse that led straight to Tank. I had to see him, talk to this bizarre outsider who'd sideswiped my family, who'd unwittingly released me from my medic duties. Brain crackling with such thoughts, I must have veered off course. A warning siren blasted from the feds' towers, and I near leaped out of my skin. Hands over my ears, I skidded over loose gravel, hit the ground hard. I scrambled away from the trench and the noise, remembering the last guy who'd danced with the Gatlings. As I shuddered on the ground, the sirens cut off mid-squeal. I waited, but the robotic recording never started its Judgment Day countdown. I blew sweaty hair out of my eyes and stared at the impassive face of the nearest tower. Was there someone staring back?
Did I get too close? Did a guard slip and hit a button, or were sunspots witching the supposed magnetic field?
I scowled and waited for my heart to settle. Then I got up, took two showy steps away from the cordon of signs, and walked on. At Tank's worksite, I lurked behind the foreman's trailer, studying Tank. He leaned against a truck with his company logo on it, a dense black capital T locked inside a circle. Arms resting on the lip of the truck bed, he conferred with a tall, sunburned woman about jackhammers. The position cocked his left hip, tightened his jeans over his ass, cleared my mind of the mortal terror I'd just experienced. Above his leather belt, a spread of sweat stained his gray shirt black. I followed the narrowing black strip to its apex between his shoulder blades. The vertical line accentuated the angle of those wide shoulders. I imagined extending the line all the way to the base of his shaved scalp with my tongue. I'd squirmed then, and hearing my boots scrape gravel, he turned around. The sun glinted off his wristwatch, blinding me. I blinked to clear my sight, and suddenly he was standing close enough I could smell him. Limey sweat, caliche dust, trace of sandalwood. And evidently, he'd smelled me. Could he smell me now in his bed? I swallowed, found my voice.
Most guys think I smell like cookies. From the waist up, anyway.
When he said nothing, I thought I'd gone too far and tried to get back on track.
So I can use the shower?
He pointed.
My robe's in the back of the door. Toss your clothes out and I'll throw them in the wash.
He watched me slide out of bed. Clean freak, I wondered. Or control freak. But gift horses and all that, so I didn't argue. The water stung my scuffed knees. I figured my soap and shampoo, more than niceties, were suggestions that I keep my mitts off his stuff. After my shower, I sat on the commode and opened the drawers of his vanity anyway. Found his shaving supplies, slathered aloe on my abrasions. When I emerged from the bathroom toweling my hair, Tank wasn't there. I listened for the washing machine, but the wars were raging outside. I couldn't hear much more than motorcycles and screaming. I walked down to the living room. Where would the laundry room be? Basement? I wandered past the kitchen and down the alcoved hallway. In the light of day, I saw one alcove was actually a doorway with steps leading down to darkness. I didn't see a light switch.
Looking for me?
I whirled. Tank stood right behind me, a half-eaten apple in hand. I pressed a palm to my chest.
God, give me a fucking coronary! Where are my clothes, Copperfield?
You're on the right track.
He gestured with the apple down into the dark. I hesitated. He reached from behind me and flicked a switch on the sloped ceiling. A series of lights low on the wall illuminated the treads, but I still didn't move. Confession. I liked the sensation of him looming behind me. Maybe also the crazy fear he'd push me to my death.
Go on.
At the foot of the stairs, Tank moved past me to the center of the dim concrete room and pulled a cord overhead. Fluorescent light revealed a wall of storage lockers to our left, the laundry and a semi-enclosed half-bath to the right. I blinked. The basement was nearly the size of the Cantu's whole house. Tank walked over to the machines, checked the time left on the cycle.
Almost.
I joined him beside the washer. I thought about him handling my underwear and felt my cheeks redden. Stupid to be embarrassed. He'd handled them a lot more the night before.
You want me to walk you home?
They'll kill me.
I mean, after they've torn you apart.
I thought maybe this was your elaborate form of suicide.
I'm not elaborate. As if to demonstrate, no plan occurred to me. I simply blurted instead. Can I stay here? He pitched the core into a wastebasket by the washer.
How long?
As long as you'll let me. He turned to me, and I had to lift my eyes to gauge his reaction. He wiped a drop from my cheek with one knuckle, finished chewing.
I won't throw you to the wolves. I don't drown kittens or kick old people either, so you can stop with the eyes.
I hadn't meant to give him the velvet painting orphan eyes. Not that I could help it, the width of my eyes being nearly a third greater than the interpupil distance. But I averted my gaze.
Besides,
he picked me up and set me on the washer.
I'm not quite done with you yet.
I looked up and saw a slow smile spreading across his face. I grabbed fistfuls of his t-shirt and tugged him into the V of my parted legs. His mouth tasted of apple, his skin of street smoke. Once I was well and truly fucked, and my clothes were dry, Tank showed me the rest of his house. It was the largest on our block. In all the inner radius. 3 years before, Tank had paid off the previous tenants and scraped two lots clean. Then built his house to be as intimidating as he was. Not an unwise strategy for an outsider, though back then I'd thought it pretty pointless, since most outsiders died within 5 years. That was one reason I hadn't paid much attention to Tank when he first arrived, though his physical charms were visible from a distance. Also, I'd been hyper-focused on studying for the 4S test that could spring me from exile. Tank and I hadn't been neighbors so much as two workaholics passing in the night. Then I'd failed the exam and gone hermit, as Serena had so helpfully pointed out. But now as we walked the halls, I discovered Tank's house wasn't a brute bulwark. He'd outfitted it with technologies heard of, but usually impossible to maintain in exile. On the ground floor, he'd embedded an immense telescreen in one living room wall. Near the front door, a control panel streamed three video feeds simultaneously. One from the door-mounted camera that panned the front yard, and two more swiveling atop the palisades. Other labeled switches on the console indicated that cameras swept every angle of Tank's property. He could arm or disarm the security system or specific points of entry from the panel. He had sound dampeners too, which created an invisible dome to buffer the house from street noise. The dampeners weren't on at that moment. I followed Tank in silence, trying to calculate how much all this tech had cost. I couldn't. I didn't know enough about the economy out there. Nevertheless, I figured the energy gobbled up by his electronic rampart had to dwarf the monthly kilowatt ration each household in exile received. Tank must have been wealthy out there to be paying that much here. Under the stairs, a guest bathroom featured the same hypnotic tiles and sleek chrome fixtures as in Mute's bathrooms, which made me feel a little better. A sign of frugality. Across the hall, a guest room echoed, empty but for a floor lamp. Another relief. On the second floor near the top of the stairs, a fortified picture window overlooked Raven Street. I'd rarely had a bird's eye view of exile. My bedroom in my parents' house faced the backyard, so I couldn't help slowing, then stopping, to stare. I scanned the horizon, seeking signs of life out there, beyond Exile's triple border. The tire fires raised inky curtains of smoke, obscuring any glimpse I might have caught of Gatling Drive. I saw the watchtowers, but their blank stares disarmed me, sent my gaze scuttling back to the street below. Down there, Sweeney punched a thug in the face. Nearby, knots of warriors fought for weapons, vehicles, pride, and, most elusive of all, dominance. Tank stood beside me, the usual heat radiating off him.
Does it bother you? I can roll down the steel side and...
He indicated a crank in the wall. I realized my mouth was hanging open. I closed it. It only bothers me when I'm working. I chose not to explain that I was almost always working, with brief forays into the wild for food and sex. Even then, I just set the noise dampeners. I looked to the right, searching for my parents' house, and wondered what was left of my old room. Tank shifted his weight, arms over his chest, but said nothing.
Speaking of work, I guess it's too late for you to get to your job site, unless you want to wade through that.
I waved at the tangle of warriors and bikes below. He nodded, staring out at the fights, mouth turned up in that facial shrug.
Sorry to inconvenience you.
If you've been inconvenient, I can't wait till you become a real pain in the ass.
I lifted one knee to the window seat and side-eyed him.
Careful what you wish for.
He didn't pull his gaze from the fighting. I couldn't quite read him, and I suspected he was equally baffled by me. But I might have unnerved him. The masseter muscle in his jaw flexed one, two, three times.
You can go if you want. I can entertain myself.
I tried to ignore the tips of a bonfire on my parents' lawn. He shook his head slowly.
Nah, it's out of my system for a while.
I toyed with my earrings, considering. If Tank's violent energies built up over time, And unlike my ragey cohorts, he could make a conscious decision to purge those homicidal tendencies. That explained the intermittent warrior thing. It also suggested some interesting possibilities. The quarantine imposed on Exile was semi-permeable. Just as we couldn't see into the panopticons, but the guards could see us via one-way glass, we couldn't leave town unless we passed the Fed's 4S test. You had to be strong, smart, sane, and sterile. All defined, of course, exclusively by the Feds. But outsiders who agreed to implement jobs programs could get visas and move into Exile for 5 years at a time, so long as they didn't have criminal records. Generally, any outsider who didn't turn tail and run in the first 2 weeks ended up in the street wars. Guess you had to be a little insane to begin with to want to come to Exile. Or the Fed's screening measures left something to be desired. In any case, most outsiders expired before their visas did. But not Tank. He'd been in Exile for 3 years. And I guessed he aimed to stay more or less intact, intended to leave again one day. He seemed to like me, at least as far as he could throw me. Maybe when that one day came.
What about your stuff?
It took me a few seconds to understand. I was plotting. Shit. In my head, I was already halfway out of town. I shrugged, forced myself to focus. Tonight. Mother might be exhausted by then. As if. There's not much to get. Even less if she's broken into my room and started demolishing things. Mostly I want my thesis stuff. It was out before I knew it. Tank tilted his head, looked at me.
Thesis? What you were telling Serena about last night?
Yeah. Probably sounds stupid, studying anything in this hellhole. He shook his head, thinned his lips in what physiognomists called an AU-14, the meh expression.
I'll put a building so they can burn them down again. Who's stupider?
He traded half a smile for my half a laugh.
I didn't realize the telestudy program covered college, let alone grad school.
It wasn't meant to, but half-assed as the guidelines are, there wasn't anything to stop me. I would have preferred pre-med, but there wasn't a way to do the labs. The Feds don't exactly trust us with chemistry sets. Anyway, even if I finish, it won't mean anything. Not here. He shrugged.
It's your work. That's enough.
Given the brutal work schedule I'd heard he kept, I didn't think the sentiment was merely job maker propaganda. He nodded at the street.
If you want, I can come over with you. Help you carry stuff.
I glanced toward my parents, relieved to change the subject. Only now a flagpole leaned in the front yard. A burning effigy of Tank dangling from it. Mother smacked the scarecrow body, sent it spinning around the flagpole like a tetherball of death. The twins, Thing 1 and Thing 2, stood on the roof hurling rocks at Tank's house. Their missiles didn't touch the barricades on Tank's side. But given time and the right materials, that would change.
You want to carry your spleen? Don't bother. I can smuggle a flash drive across the street.
I should have brought it with me. But who could think straight with Mother sobbing and slamming things? I'd figured I'd get back home before the crew ratted me out. Tank nodded, seemingly unaffected by my family's display or the street battles. Hand on his smooth scalp, he drifted toward his study, down the hall from the bedroom.
I've got some drafting to do.
Then go do it. I turned on my heel and headed downstairs.
There's stuff in the fridge.
Yeah, there was. Mostly fruits and vegetables, and not just the hearty root stock from the government dole. I drank a glass of filtered water and carried a handful of dried apricots back to the living room. I had to study the control panel for a bit before understanding how to work the noise dampeners, but I thought Tank might appreciate the quiet also. In the engineered calm, I lay on the couch and wondered how the hell I'd get in and out of my parents' house alive. Compared to Tank's, my parents' home was a toad abode. Father worked more than most exiles. His mechanic skills were in high demand, plus the terms of Mother's house arrest required his gainful employment. Still, almost all our money, the government stipends all households received, and whatever Father earned working for Rat Rod at the junkyard or doing odd jobs in town, got funneled back into the street wars. William always needed new elbow pads or another Kevlar vest or bigger brass knuckles. We didn't even have sound dampeners, in spite of living on the sidelines. The savages didn't care. They loved the noise. I had to rig my own localized dampeners from specs I found on the internet, and I ran the damn things night and day. There were, of course, drawbacks to that bit of DIY. One night I got back from a good time, and Father ambushed me in the kitchen.
What the hell are you doing up there? We exceeded our kilowatt allowance for the next 3 months. Where am I supposed to get the money to pay for that?
The feds aren't gonna cut our power. We're the only people on the block who pay the difference.
I tried to dodge around him.
We're the only ones with a person under house arrest. We can't afford to flip off the powers that be. You really want to take the chance that they'll cut...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.